Today is March 23rd, and I am like really holding back tears right now, and I'm going to explain why. I did cry a bit when this conversation happened, and I was okay, and then I hit record because I know I'm going to talk about this, and it's like a ball in my throat or whatever that saying is, where it's just like really hard to swallow, want to cry, and I'm sure I'll cry a lot over the next who knows how long. Okay, so the astrology right now is so just on point with the conversation I had a few hours ago. Or really like an hour ago. And right now, Mercury is in Pisces, about to make an exact conjunction, which is, you know, being in the same space time, like the same point they're having their meeting in Pisces. Or I did say Pisces, right? Yeah. Which can bring about, you know, it's all kind of coexisting with illusions, right? Things being illuminated, possibly being disillusioned, seeing things for what they truly are. Or, you know, there's, like I said, the potential of the illusion, like lies and things of that nature, right? But it's all really, the core of it is just the comprehension of reality, what that really means, and possibly having a conversation about it, writing about it, you know. So very relevant to what I experienced this morning. And so I mentioned before that I have a connection with, I don't know if I mentioned that it's my divine counterpart, definitely my divine counterpart. And this person's, you know, in Australia. I'm like, do I want to put their location out there? But, you know, I already said that in the previous recording, so whatever. I don't care. It's like on the other side of the world of where I am, right? And almost 20 years older than me. I mean, this connection, you know, is so, it is just the fact that it even happened or is, you know, there's, yeah, I mean, I just, so many emotions right now. I can't even really speak clearly. But I wanted to catch this emotion. I guess I'll start with something in my chart. And I'll just be honest. So, you know, I'm in a relationship with my daughter's father, my partner here in real time, in the same space time. And I mean, we've had, like I said, we've had our ups and downs. It's good right now. I mean, it's all right. It's not blowing my dick off. It's not like super exciting. And we've just been, you know, in survival mode and, you know, just focusing on our priorities, which is our daughter and paying bills and the things, the 3D things that are just frustrating. There hasn't really been a lot of fun. There hasn't even been any like sexual connection. I just really not on his part. It's more on my part. And I've noticed that with my relationships, the past 3 relationships, like including this one, after a certain time, sex becomes a thing, right? And what's happening is that there's like no sex. There's no interest in intimacy with the person. So when I was married back in 2013, that's when we got married, and we were divorced by 2015. I think we had got together in like 2011, started dating. And so, you know, we got married. Everything was great, amazing. I mean, we did our relationship was a lot of partying, doing a lot of cocaine, drinking. This was like the leading into my Saturn return. And, you know, it just wasn't, Yeah, I mean, it was hot and heavy. And then, you know, I like basically proposed to him. It wasn't really a proposal. I was just like, hey, like we should get married. And we were like drunk and high on blow, right? So it's like, of course, you had that conversation, or people tend to have that conversation. So we joked around about it. We're like, yeah. But then 6 months later, we actually got married. I think it was like 6 months later after having that conversation, like it really became a thing. And so, and this was really interesting, like for everyone, because he, my ex-husband, was like a known bachelor. I think he was like, he's 14 years older than me. So I was like 26 or 27 when we started dating. I think 26. So that would make him like almost 40. Yeah, because I remember he's about to turn 40. So, you know, I'm really into older men. It's just I don't have time for the younger ones. Like, they're just not, they haven't been through enough or matured enough. I don't know. I mean, my partner now, he is 8 years younger than me, but he's definitely, like, we're, as far as maturity and things of that nature, we're at, like, pretty much in the same level. So, yeah, so we got married. And when we got married, there was, like, no more, like, sexual connect. The sexual connection kind of just, like, disappeared. And I think, you know, reflecting back, I think it was his just whatever, him processing like, oh, wow, I'm in a committed relationship. And that may have been a little bit suffocating for him because, you know, usually he does whatever he wants, right? I don't think it was a matter of like wanting to be with other people, but or like, yeah, with other women or whatever. I think it was just like the idea of being, you know, having to be with someone else or have someone. Anyways, you get what I'm saying. Lockdown, essentially. And for me, you know, I was getting ready to graduate college. You know, I went to school late. And I sobered up. Like, and we both, he got sober as well for the most part. I don't know if he started like back up again towards the end. I have a feeling, like as far as cocaine, we're definitely still drinking. But not like we were before, not like continuously partying and stuff like that. Come on, step up. Sorry, I just got distracted. So yeah, like we got sober and we're just like, wait, what happened? Like, and we were, you know, somewhat different people. And I know I definitely was changing and I started getting back into like witchcraft and just doing rituals and stuff and really like really working with my or doing a lot of readings just for myself. And just, you know, it was like the vibe was different, you know, and he would always comment like, oh, you should be careful with what you're doing. Like, you don't want to play with that stuff. And I'm just like, dude, I've been doing this for like, at that point, it was over 10 years. You know, he just didn't really see that. Like, he's always seen my cards and the astrology, but he never really saw like the rituals and stuff like that. And I was getting a lot more crystals and things. So he was just like, you know, feeling like I was going into like a dark place possibly, which I mean, I kind of was. And that's a whole nother experience that I had shared, you know, in my old diary. Anyways, so we didn't have sex for like 2 years and then the marriage was dissolved, right? We got divorced. And so then I met my ex. Well, we were already working together. And he kind of helped me out when I was separated. He let me use his car because I had no longer had a car, and the job I was working, I needed to be at work like really early in the morning. So there was no, public transportation that early, and I wasn't going to do like Lyft or Uber. I think Lyft and Uber just became a thing, around that time anyways, like that. And so, you know, he let me use his car and we were really good friends. We would hang out. I'm sure he was like into me, but we were just friends. And then eventually, long story short, I was just like, you know, I'm horny and I haven't, you know, had sex in a while. who should I hook up with? Oh, let me just hook up with Matt because I'm already driving his car. This is really convenient. You know, maybe, you know, I should just put out, right? So it was already conditional starting that relationship where me feeling, I didn't feel obligated, but I had that intention. I was like, well, I'm driving his car, so it only makes sense that, you know, we could hook up. We're friends anyways. Like, he's cool. That turned into a relationship because I'm just like not the person to have casual sex. And so that became really hot and heavy. I ended up getting pregnant and I had a miscarriage like almost 4 months in. And when I had that miscarriage, after that, I just like naturally, you know, I didn't have a sex drive. I was just like really scared of getting pregnant again. Didn't know if I wanted to have a kid. I just felt there was a lot of trauma, you know, in my sacral and root chakra and, you know, solar plexus leading from that. And so, and this is my second pregnancy. The first time was when I was 16 and that was a whole thing. And wow, I'm just like an open book right now with relationships. And this is going to be a long one. So hope you have some tea or a glass of wine. I wish I had that right now, but you know, it's not even noon yet. Maybe I'll make some tea when I get done. I just wasn't feeling sexual and he understood that. But I think after possibly, and we had sex here and there, it just wasn't like he could pick up on the fact that I was just doing it out of obligation. Like I wasn't really into it. I was really nervous about getting pregnant because it's really easy for me to get pregnant. I don't take birth control because my hormones are already kind of all over the place at times. Like, even birth control with zero hormones, which I feel like is BS, doesn't work for me. I'm very sensitive to it. So I wasn't on birth control. So I just like was very tense. I wasn't like relaxed. And so, what was I going to say? Yeah. So, and then it got to a point where I just didn't want to have sex anymore. I was just like, I don't even want to fake it. And after a while, you know, he naturally, you know, he just began to take it personally. And I mean, there were other things going on in the relationship. He was financially supporting me because I had, you know, quit my job to pursue my spiritual path. And I eventually ran out of savings. And, you know, there was a short moment where I needed to, where I was going to get a part-time job, or I did at a greenhouse, but so that was kind of stressful for him because he has his own trauma with money and survival, security, and all those things. So it triggered him in a very intense way. And then we weren't sexually connected. And so, you know, naturally, you know, I understand his position, but also, you know, I have to live in my own truth. And so he took it personally, and then he kind of got, you know, nasty about it and was just like, I don't understand why you can't just like have sex, you know? And I think he even mentioned the car thing, or he's like, I'm helping you in all these ways. And like, this is the one thing, like, you can help me, essentially. Not his exact words, but that was pretty much, you know, the gist of what was said. And that ended up leading to the end of our relationship, naturally. And then I met my partner that I'm with now, and that was hot and heavy. And I got pregnant like 6 months into the relationship, and, you know, a lot happened, and we ended up moving from Colorado to New York, where he's from. And, we've just like, once we got here, even when I was pregnant before I had my daughter, we were in survival mode, because it's like, we got, you know, you're trying to build the nest, and, you know, I'm trying to grow my business. You know, he had just moved to Colorado. We met online, and then he like moved to Colorado to be with me. It was a whole thing. And so, yeah, it all happened really fast. And my point is, the reason why I'm going through all of this, you know, like I said, we haven't had sex in like a month and a half. And I just don't have the desire because I don't feel sexually connected because our chemistry, what we desire, is not aligned right now. And I like what I'm really desiring is, it's not that he can't give it to me, but I'm going to be straight up. You know, if he listens to this, he listens to it. But like, I'm desiring to be intimate with someone else. And this is the way life works. I thought, you know, I could be an open relationship person, but I just really am not. And so I can only have what I've learned. I feel sexual desires for, you know, one person at a time. Not meaning that I don't find other people attractive or I don't love them or whatever, but it's just like the way my mind works, my heart works, my desires work, it's only can like be focused on one person at a time, which I'm learning. And so right now it's, you know, unfortunately not with my partner. And there are other reasons for that, just not a sexual thing. It's just due to things that have happened over the course of our relationship that's just put that distance there. So not including, you know, obviously my long distance connection. So again, the point of me even saying this, I didn't even tell what happened, but I wanted to record here anyways about learning about my Uranus connection to Venus in my chart. So Uranus and Venus in my chart, they are in a square, which is a point of conflict. And and this is like an astrologer that I really love. Even though obviously I'm an astrologer, I know what it means. It's always good to hear, you know, to be validated that you're not crazy from somebody else. And to put in a nutshell, what she spoke about with people with this placement is that you desire, you know, the like eccentric love, eccentric relationship, spontaneity, even long distance relationships, or just something like basically routine kills your sexual connection after a while. Or just like, yeah, if everything's kind of the same day to day, it's like, there's no excitement. I need, you know, excitement to really spark that flame. And, you know, eccentric, unconventional relationships are kind of like a thing for people who have Uranus square Venus. And that's what I've realized. I'm like, you know, when it comes to with my ex-husband finally, you know, being married and trying to have that life, didn't work for me or him. It just killed that fire. And with my ex-boyfriend, I think it was just, you know, the nature of, you know, that was a unique relationship. While it was, you know, special in its own way, it wasn't, you know, I think that was kind of like a intermission, like not necessarily more than a rebound, but, you know, not compared to my ex-husband and, you know, my partner now. And I hate to compare in that way, but it is what it is. And so, you know, but with my partner now, like I said, we're focusing on raising my daughter and creating that home and stuff like that, which is great. The security feels good, but it's just missing the desire. And I think my partner and I are just kind of the same when it even comes to who initiates it or who like I like to be like, I can admit I'm a romantic lover, or I like romance. I love poetry. I love just like, yeah, just like, I mean, my partner doesn't even like if people kiss in a movie, like, I mean, really passionately intimate kissing, he's just kind of like, okay, like he gets kind of bothered by it. I don't know if he thinks it's gross, but I mean, something along those lines. And so there's like not a lot of that passion. And it's like, I really want that. And I think I want it ongoing. And my relationships, you know, they're like that at first, like any relationship. And for me, it's like once it gets like that passion, you know, dissipates, which happens in relationships, it's natural, I tend to lose any sexual desire. And I'm like, okay, so I go seeking that elsewhere. Or, you know, I just like will shut down to the point where it's like, oh, you know, eventually it's like, we're going to break up. You know, I just don't, well, with my ex, I did break up with him, but it was literally like the universe had to intervene, or my spirit guides really intervene with that one, to the point where I couldn't even like take his like smell. And he didn't, it wasn't BO, it was like an energetic thing. So I couldn't even literally hug him. And it was to the point where we could no longer ignore it. It was just like, okay, like you don't even want me to touch you. So it's just interesting. I'm learning my own relationship patterns. So anyways, I began this recording, this entry, about wanting to just briefly discuss what the conversation I had this morning with my divine counterpart, and which is what I'm going to just call him now. And, he just basically messaged me, being upfront about, just the nature of what's going on with our connection, and how, you know, long story short, it's to the point where the excitement has kind of dwindled a bit, and due to the fact that, you know, it's been like almost a year, and, you know, if you can't be physical after a certain point, it's kind of just like almost like torture. Like the fire's still there with both of us, you know, the desire's still there, but there's just, it's just really hard. And if there's no, you know, way, like it's like almost, it's like there's no chance. I believe in anything's possible, but it just seems like really hard right now to that the chance of us being able to meet in person and do anything or be together just doesn't seem like it's actually going to happen. And, you know, even then with him, he's like, you know, and I, he was like, I can't even commit to that. He was like, you know, he could only commit if it's like something that's not even just like a one-time thing, but like something that is long-lasting, or there's a future there. You know, he just, he's very Scorpio. He's got like the most Scorpio I've ever seen in one person. At least in all the right places. And so like, it's like all or nothing essentially to at this point. And obviously it's going to like, it's not happening, right? I'm in a relationship. I'm not going to Australia. He's not necessarily coming here because he might not even be able to get to back home with the on and off lockdowns and all of those things, which I don't know if they're doing anymore. Oh, she just told me to shut up. That means it's probably my time to end this, because it's already been over 20 minutes. That's the best. It's going to be hard to record these when she starts like really repeating what I'm saying, because I know she's hearing all this. So yikes. But she's not even saying full sentences, so I have some time. But yeah, so I'm just really, at least I can have a laugh right now. I'm really sad. Because I just, it's like you want to be with someone, but like what, you know, I don't know. And there was definitely something deeply spiritual within our connection, like the purpose. And that purpose has been realized for sure. We definitely agree on that. Like, and now it's kind of like, all right, I don't know if this is going to like, if it's worthwhile to keep doing this. So I don't know. But Mercury and freaking Neptune and Pisces. I just want to stay in La La Land. I have Venus and Mars in Pisces. And, you know, I just love living in a fantasy world, which is why this was ideal for me, right? This like long distance connection. It just really helped to, I just didn't have to like even think about it. Helped when there was a lot of challenges and things going on where I could just escape to this fantasy. And now it's like, ugh, I'm like on my own, and it's just really, I don't want to do it. I want to live in my fantasy world. And it's fun to have someone there with you. Like, I'm still going to definitely live in my fantasy, but like, you know, I don't know. My divine counterpart is just, this was not supposed to happen, okay, for divine counterparts right now. So I'm curious, you know, and that's the thing. We've also had this conversation like 6 months ago. Not to this extent, I feel, because now it's really like, okay, like what is all of this? Where is this going? Really, because it's been almost a year. And last time we had this conversation was about 6 months or so ago. So, and we still kept talking. So, I mean, who knows what will really happen? Only time will tell. I'm only living in the moment. And right now, this moment is pretty emotionally intense and sad and sobering, you know? And so it's like, well, now you have to figure out how to be like just enjoying what's around you, like fully, which I do. But, you know, it did help to have that, you know, connection there. So we'll see. I will definitely keep this updated. And yeah, so I'll talk to you all soon.